You're watching the American Conference on ESPN. The Liberty Bowl, the home of the West champs in the American the last 2 years, trying to be that 3 years in a row. They do it with a win over Cincinnati as the two top-rated group of five teams get together this afternoon in Memphis. Cincinnati is already in the American Championship with a win. The game happens at Nippert Stadium in Cincy. With a Memphis win, they're right back here, both these two teams, next week. Jason Benetti, Rod Gilmore, Quint Kesnick is downstairs. Look, a lot of teams are very interested in this game. Boise State, among others, but Cincinnati and Memphis are the top two looking to go to the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic.
This is the best race we've ever had for a group of five team to get to a New Year's Six game this year, the Cotton Bowl. And with Boise State sitting back, watching to see how these two teams play out today and possibly next week, it's a great race.
We have very possible big play theater with this Memphis offense. Dangerous, dynamic, and explosive, and they will get the ball first.
Did you say fun?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
A lot of fun, this offense. You may have seen it a couple of weeks ago when game day was here. SMU and Memphis put up over 100 points combined. And will Cincinnati's defense show enough resistance this afternoon? Cincinnati and Memphis are underway. And it is a short kickoff from the 10-yard line. Clay Brooks on the return. And he has dazzling speed. Clay Brooks into open space. And Chris Clay Brooks scores. Another house call for Memphis. There is a flag down, as they have put another one in on a kickoff return. It was a late flag. It's at the 23-yard line.
This has been given its first sideline warning of the game.
You trade a sideline warning for an opening kick six any day.
Absolutely. We've talked about the explosiveness of their offense, but how about Pete Limbo's special teams? He coaches this, and he said he had these guys primed for this game, some stuff ready, and right off the bat, there they go. This is an extremely fast team, not just offense and defense, but they are loaded on their special teams as well. 94 yards.
What did the defensive coordinator, Adam Fuller, tell us yesterday? He said our fastest guy in the secondary is Chris Clay Brooks, and we saw him on the opening kickoff.
Yeah, and it didn't take many blocks. He got a couple at the start, and the hole opened up in the middle of the field. And again, the speed on their special teams is greater than what Cincinnati has on their special teams. It's something that Memphis talked about all week, trying to use their speed advantage, but who knew it would happen right off the bat, Q.
Yeah, and Luke Fickell told us his biggest concern was his kickoff team, whether they're going to kick it to Clay Brooks, who's known for his blinding speed, or Antonio Gibson, who's returned some to the house this season. But you can see that the way they sustain their blocks, Memphis has a belief that any play can be a big play.
Yeah, Q, the speed differential may show up in other areas of the kicking game. This is a very, very fast Memphis team.
And now the question for Cincinnati of whether or not they'll have their usual starting quarterback gets a little hairier, because if they don't, they're already suddenly down 7-0. Des Ritter, the regular starter, banged up. Ben Bryant, the freshman, looks like he's going to get his first start as the return ends up right around the 25-yard line for Trey Tucker. Quint, what you got on the quarterbacks?
Well, both quarterbacks came out, and Desmond Ritter warmed up earlier. This is a quarterback. He's led his team to a 10-1 record, but he injured his right shoulder, his throwing shoulder, 2 weeks ago against South Florida. He has been subpar since that, less than 50%, no touchdowns, and one pick. And so Ben Bryant will make his first career start today, the redshirt freshman from Chicago. Talk about a big moment to debut. This kid's got an excellent arm. He's a slinger, probably not as effective with the quarterback run game.
Out of Lyons Township High School, and he hits the deck. His first chance ends up on the turf. Joseph Dorsey has got there.
And that was supposed to be a quick pass, quick release. And Brian held the ball a little bit long, and then there's your sack. It's got to come out really quickly. One step, get rid of it, and you will see Memphis attack the right side of that line today.
They're so good at getting losses on first down. And Cincinnati gets most of it back. Michael Warren, the junior tailback, who's going to be so important for Cincinnati if they're going to keep in this game, as TJ Carter is down for Memphis, the defensive back, junior out of Nashville. Cincinnati's going to have to lean on that run game, Rod.
Well, when you lose your quarterback, Ritter, who's a pretty good runner, now your quarterback run game kind of goes away. And so Warren's going to have to carry a much heavier load today because, you know, he's the guy. He's the runner now.
Luke Fickell in his third season trying to go for back-to-back 11-win seasons for the Cincinnati Bearcats. They had two 11-win seasons in their first 132 years as a program. And Carter is still down over on the sideline, the Tennessee native. Let's take a look at how Carter went down. You see him engage, then he gets rolled.
It happens an awful lot in this game. Guys roll up on you.
All right, you were a DB. There's nothing you can do.
No,
right?
I mean, you know, you're occupied with the receiver. Something's happening behind you, and it just rolls up on you. There's not much you can do about it.
Important part of this secondary, TJ Carter, and he's going to have to be helped off by the Memphis training staff.
He's their best man-to-man cover guy out there. So when you take him out of that lineup, how does it impact the defense? Do they play more zone coverage? Do they have enough confidence? You know, Claybrook will probably step in and be the starter over there, but do they want Claybrook to play man-to-man as much as, you know, they did with Carter?
That's good news, bad news for Memphis. They had Sanchez Blake Jr. back in the lineup, their leading tackler, when he was hurt against Tulane. He returns, Carter leaves, and it's third down for Cincinnati against a Memphis defense been pretty good on third down this year, top 50 in the country. It's a run for Warren. And he gets to the outside. Warren down the sideline turns it into a gash for Cincinnati. And you get the sinking feeling that seven's not going to win it this afternoon.
No, going to need a little bit of help with that. Nice way to field to the outside and get the edge. Poor job by Memphis setting the edge out there.
Junior out of Toledo. He was originally committed to Kentucky, then swapped to Toledo, and then Cincinnati. And boy, are they happy to have him. Bryant nearly intercepted. He wanted the tight end to Guara, who's going to be very important today.
You know the phrase, the middle of the field is dark and full of terror.
Full of terror.
Especially for young quarterbacks. And that one was almost picked.
It was a linebacker, J.J. Russell, that almost picked it.
Got to be careful with the young guys throwing over the middle. They tend to lose the linebackers in there.
That's got to be a hold. No flag, however, as Warren gets a couple of yards. Jacoby Francis with the tackle, and third down coming up. What a scene you just saw in Charlottesville, Virginia Tech and Virginia. You missed the opening kickoff going for a touchdown here in Memphis with the two top group of five teams vying to see who's going to play in the American Conference Championship game next week. Cincinnati is already there. Memphis with a win would get there and would host Cincinnati. With a loss, they would need Navy to lose tomorrow in their final game. Thanks for joining us. Jason Benetti, Rod Gilmore, Quinn Kesnick with you. As Cincinnati got an opening kickoff touchdown from Chris Claybrooks, and the Bearcats down to their second quarterback because of injury. Going for it on fourth down. They are 7-for-10 this year. It's a run to the outside, and Cincinnati does have the first down to the 11. Wilson Huber, the tight end, the fourth tight end for the Bearcats, gets the first down.
Well, he gets a little trickeration. This snap does not go to the quarterback. It goes right to Huber. Watch this. Yep. And he almost lost that snap, but held on to it to easily get to the edge and pick up 13 yards on the first down.
That was really hard to see from field level. A lot of the Memphis players, I don't think, recognized who had the ball.
Yeah, they froze a little bit, didn't they? As Bryant, the freshman, hands it off, and Warren, who's so good after contact, isn't going to beat four dark shirts. So Memphis, who's won the American Conference West the last 2 years, trying to do it for a third straight season under Mike Norvell, and for Luke Fickle, building the Cincinnati program to double-figure wins the last 2 years. The first quarter has been a struggle.
Well, in the red zone, he gets a little help when he thinks about his tight end, Iguara, 83. He's been important in the red zone.
Warren up the middle to set up third down. How do they try and get him open?
Well, sometimes they sneak him across, you know, the old fake block and then release. But he's been the number one target down there, and Memphis is well aware of that. So if you've got a deceptive play using your tight end, now's the time, because Memphis is aware of this.
They've also got height mismatches. Cincinnati tall wide receivers on the outside,
including 6'5 Malik Moj at the bottom of your screen. Bryant to the top, and it's incomplete for Pierce. Clay Brooks, who brought the opening kickoff to the house, had the coverage, and it's fourth down Bearcats. But for his first start, Ben Bryant gets the Bearcats in field goal range in his first drive at least.
Well, and for his first start, that was a nice drive for him. I mean, he took a sack, got a hit, got the butterflies knocked out of his system, and then completed a pass and did a nice job in the run game. So he's got to feel pretty good about the start to this game.
25 yards for Sam Crosa. High snap and a marker down. We expect some penalties in this game. Both teams heavily penalized to the tune of 140 yards a game combined.
False start. Offense, number 11. 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
You know, we saw last night, maybe you saw it around college football, penalties can hurt kicking units. I don't know if you knew. It becomes a problem.
Got to make it again now for the kicker.
You're referring to Ole Miss, Mississippi State in the Egg Bowl.
The Egg Bowl got a little dicey.
Yeah.
Late. From 30 this time for Crosa. And he's got it again. He said, park me anywhere, I'm happy to boot it through for you. Memphis leading 7-3 early on. Can you feel the rush taking over all your senses? Welcome back to ABC College Football, presented by TrackPhone. We are on pace for a rather electric game today. 7-3, Memphis with the lead. And the Memphis 7 happened real quick, like opening kickoff quick. Chris Claybrook's right down the seam.
You know, there's a reason most teams don't kick to Memphis, because they're afraid of things like this. And Claybrook's showed you that speed. And there is a huge speed advantage for Memphis when you talk about special teams today. Let's see what Cincinnati does going forward.
You know, part of the problem is Ryan Jones, the kickoff specialist for Cincinnati, has just 13 touchbacks in 64 kickoffs all year. Claybrooks again. He stalls, and now he's down at the 22-yard line. So that worked out better on the angled kick. And Brady White, redshirt junior out of Hart High School, famed for Trevor Bauer, the major league pitcher, among others. But Brady White is a guy that Mike Norvell has known for a long time, dating back to his Arizona State days. He took over for Riley Ferguson, who left for the NFL, and the 30 passing touchdowns is in part a building of a rapport with his wide receivers in his second season.
Right. Remember that White transferred from Arizona State. Norvell was a highly regarded offensive coordinator there before he got the head coaching job here.
right to throw. He has a multitude of weapons on the outside, and this one completed to Demonte Coxey right on the sideline, the leading receiver. Oh, pushing over on the sideline after Coxey ended up out of bounds.
It is easy to underestimate White's skills as a quarterback because, you know, he doesn't have the big arm, but he's incredibly accurate. He gives his receivers a chance to run after the catch.
One of the best big play offenses in the country, the Memphis Tigers, in part because of the guy in the backfield right now, Kenny Gainwell, a redshirt freshman who is absolutely dazzling. And there's Gainwell just short of the 40. It's a first down. This Memphis offense has 27 plays of 40 plus yards. That's the most in the nation.
This is a big play offense. Gainwell is in the middle of it. He is the focus of the rushing attack, and he is pretty much there in the passing attack too. He's the second leading receiver on this team, but it's all about big plays when you talk about the Memphis offense.
Gainwell again up the gut, and if he's going to get that much when he's contacted, they're in real trouble when he's not. And a marker's come in at the end of the play.
Yep, a little extracurricular.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, offense number 86, and on defense number 6. That's the first unsportsmanlike foul for each player. Those fouls will offset. It'll be second down.
That's not the last time Magnifico, the tight end, and Young, the linebacker, will be matched up either.
Yeah, there'll be a little bit of that. I throw an elbow.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, if this were the NBA, there'd be a fine coming for Young for
college basketball's got a new flop rule.
Oh, that was
one warning. That's your warning. Screen game is fantastic for Memphis. Gainwell is tremendous in it himself, and he's got a first down, Tigers.
Well, you know, we started telling you how exciting he is, and people think run game only with him. But look, you split him out as a receiver. He's got great running skills, and he's a tough matchup problem. And Cincinnati is finding that out.
Brady White is split out right now at the bottom of your screen. They're going to run Wildcat here. Gainwell will take the snap. It's a lead play, and he's going to lead it all the way inside the 10. Forrest had to take him down.
What an alignment mistake by Cincinnati. They were short on that right side. Look at that. They don't have an edge player. They have nobody to turn it back in until you get to the safety out there. That is a mistake in alignment. Has to be, because they were outnumbered, outmanned.
Outgunned and outplanned,
too. Absolutely.
Because they had Gibson, the wide receiver, the long wide receiver, blocking for him in the backfield. And we all noticed that on tape this week, how good Memphis's receivers are in the blocking game.
Yeah, well, it's a lot easier to block when they don't have a guy out there for you to block either. The first thing Cincinnati's going to do when they get their defense over there is get that squared away. They can't allow the edge to be completely unguarded.
These early drives are very taxing for the defense. Multiple formations, different personnel groupings. It's a lot of different looks at tempo.
There they go, pistol into a regular shotgun. And White is over the middle, right near the goal line. Kadarian Jones, touchdown! It was a battle to get in, and he busted down the door.
How about the way he finished that run? It's simple crossing route, but watch Jones. Watch him finish this. He knows he's got people in front of him. Lower the shoulder. That's like a running back. That's not a wide receiver. That's a running back play.
He never got tackled.
No.
Through two guys, two DBs, no chance. Riley Patterson's extra point is good. Memphis once again clicking big time. They've scored 42 or more in each of their last five games. They're going to dynamite that today if they stay on pace.
College Football on ABC is presented by TracFone, the new TracFone Wireless. Now you're in control. In part by Chex, pregame to postgame. Chex is full of possibilities. And the all-new Ford Explorer, built Ford proud.
Just a preview of our Aflac trivia question. The Ducks at the Peabody Hotel. Quint, you led the Ducks a couple years ago, didn't you?
I was a duck master, and I have the duck cane with the duck head at home. It's a big fan. My daughter's friends love it.
Is there an art to leading the Ducks, Q?
They're actually almost like a dog that knows where they want to go, and you just kind of march behind them and pretend you're in charge.
Plug and play, basically, right?
It was fun. The place was packed. I mean, it's probably the most nervous I've been for a sporting event since, I was in high school.
Since Hopkins?
The place, they were three deep up in the rafters.
Wow. My goodness. Memphis's offense has been scintillating so far. It's 14-3. That last drive was an awesome one for the Tigers, and now Cincinnati will get it back. And Ben Bryant, we mentioned his first career start. He's out of LaGrange, Illinois, in South Suburban Chicago. They love his arm. They described it as a cannon for an arm. And you see what he did in high school, 59 career touchdowns for the very well-named Lions Township Lions.
Well, he was a big recruit. He was a guy who had committed to Wisconsin. And then his other teams got involved. Georgia offered him. And then Wisconsin said, well, wait a minute. We're not that interested anymore.
Yeah, it was an odd situation. He tweeted about the Georgia offer, said he had Wisconsin in his heart, and described it as a nightmare scenario when Wisconsin rescinded, as he hands to Warren on first down.
Yeah, but there's no question about his talent. Now, he changes this offense because he's not really a running quarterback. He'll have to throw a fair amount. Now, listen, they've had trouble the last couple weeks throwing the football. I don't know that they can win this game or next week's game if they don't get more production out of their passing attack.
Bryant loads up and misfires, incomplete. A flag is in on Jacoby Francis, the redshirt junior out of the state of Georgia.
Pass interference. Defense, number 32. Ball replaced in the spot of the foul, automatic. First down.
Well, just a little push. When you extend the arm, that's a problem. You see the right hand that was extended? You can have your hand on the guy. You can actually have contact. But when you extend that arm, that's pass interference.
And it's easier for the official to see while we're at it. Warren dragged down behind the line by O'Brien Goodson, who is finally back and healthy. Kevin Nagandi in the studio, what you got? Aren't you supposed to be down on energy the day after Thanksgiving, after you eat all the food and all this? We got kickoff returns flying all over the place around the country. Opening kickoff taken to the house by Chris Claybrooks of Memphis. As Bryant drops it off to the tight end, Jaguara. And Quindell Johnson, the freshman safety, got the hit. Nice tackle.
Yeah, Cincinnati is going to have to, on first down, anticipate these run blitzes a little better. That puts them in a second and long, which now creates the third and long. So now you've got a lot of pressure on Bryant, the quarterback. Can they protect him? And this is an offensive line that is very good at running. Pass protection is not their strong suit.
All the receivers looking at their play sheet. Like they weren't quite sure what the play call was.
Well, Scott, offense, number 58, 5-yard penalty, third down.
It's a left tackle, Darius Harper, new quarterback, Rod. Yeah. Stuff like that happens.
Yeah, it does. But right now, Q, do you give your quarterback a little help, protect him, draw play, screen play, or do you let him drop back and fire it?
I do not let him drop back and fire it. The only thing you think, though, if you do chuck it downfield, there's a chance we'd get a PI call. So maybe you take a shot to the outside with Pierce.
He's their speed merchant, Alec Pierce. That was where it went, and it's incomplete. You may have seen his brother Justin playing basketball for North Carolina on ESPN just yesterday. He's got a little bit more of a tropical Thanksgiving playing in Atlantis. But Alec and the offense trailing by 11.
Talent tends to run in a family, huh?
Doesn't it?
Yeah.
They have a younger brother who's also a very good basketball player and golfer coming behind them.
We stood in the wrong line for jeans, right?
Well, I was in the way back of the line. I wasn't even going to get to the window, and we knew that. Travion Samuel, the Louisville transfer. Memphis, a big lead. The mighty Mississippi overlooking a Memphis advantage. Memphis trying to get back into the American Conference Championship game for the third straight season. They lead 14-3 over Cincinnati. And this Memphis team is going to cause maybe some trouble for Boise State in the group of five. These are the top two group of five teams right now, Cincinnati and Memphis.
Right, and the folks in Boise are saying, don't forget about them.
Yep.
They're in the race. These teams are ranked 18, 19, and 20. In the playoff rankings. The lead dog, if you will wind up in the Cotton Bowl. So we got a pretty good race going.
We have a pretty good race going here, too. Kadarian Jones, ball pop free. Ahmad Gardner's got it for Cincinnati. And they let it play out. Jones had the ball spring free, and Cincinnati's freshman Gardner caught it.
Well, here's the end of the play, and you see the ball actually, I think he's actually down before that comes out anyway.
I agree. Again, you'd need indisputable video evidence to overturn.
Yeah, he hits with his left leg and elbow before that ball comes out. That was a run pass option, and the guy who makes the tackle, Jarrell White, he was the guy who came up to defend the run. So great hustle by him to get back and get involved in that play. But I think this is going to be ruled. Yeah, he's down there.
I agree with you completely.
Yep.
As do the 40,000 fans here watching it up on the big screen.
They're right. And Memphis is going to, it looks like, have tremendous field position trying to punch it in one more time.
Yeah.
I don't see anything that says that wouldn't be
well,
overturned.
And right now, the Cincinnati defense is scrambling. I don't see anything in here either, just confirming what we've seen before. There's the bodies down, then the elbow, then the ball.
Yeah, if it's just a hand, then that's different, but it's the elbow, and that's down.
Right, you said scrambling. That's a great adjective, because the word I use when I walk behind the Cincinnati defensive bench, damage control.
Yeah, well, they're not doing a good job of it, Q.
Things are moving fast right now for them, whether it's different formations, the speed of these Memphis players, managing their matchups. You know, Mike Norvell does a great job of creating matchups, and they're just so multiple.
Let's see what the result is from in the replay booth.
After further review, the runner's left knee was down before the ball became loose. Therefore, the Memphis's football. First and 10 at the 29-yard line. The game clock will start on my signal.
And I know that's 2 minutes. We'll never get back, right? But the officials let it play out, which is the better result,
yes,
because you can't then recreate it if
correct,
you don't let it play out.
Yeah.
But again, I mean, 28 plays of 40-plus for Memphis. It just keeps churning, and it's Mike Norvell running the controls behind the curtain.
This is why he's one of the hottest coaches in the game right now.
His name has popped up attached with some Power Five jobs. Brady White with a screen for Gibson.
That is the new version of the old wishbone version, run pass option fake instead of pitching it as Oklahoma.
Boy. Here we go
again. It's getting chippy out there.
It absolutely is. That was Arquan Bush, the defensive back, and Kadarian Jones. We're 10.5 minutes in, and we've seen at least three of those situations. And these guys haven't played since 2016.
And they might play again next week.
And down goes the center, Woodard.
Offside. Defense number 90, contacting the neutral zone. It's a 5-yard penalty, second down.
You talked about Norvell's name popping up in a lot of places. Part of the reason is because his offense is a little different. You know, everybody runs a spread. He's found a way to use the tight end and get a power running attack and to get big plays, and it is just really setting college football on fire.
He doesn't want to hear about spread. He doesn't like the term spread, yeah, as Taylor gets that carry just short of the marker.
He calls it a pro-style offense with spread principles.
Yeah.
But again, there's a lot going on here. Rod, you like his utilization of the tight end or H position?
I think that's the difference in his offense, Q. He'll use one or two tight ends. It gives him the ability to run inside, and it causes problems for the defense.
Brady White keeps it and angles for the first down.
And Cincinnati has had to adjust and deal with at one tight end or two tight end. Now, the problem is when you have two tight ends out there defensively, you have to play four defensive linemen, even if those aren't your best players.
So basically, you're deciding the front. Taylor. You saw Taylor down on the field, and what did you tell me when you came back to the booth?
Goodness, what a specimen. That's a big guy. They list him at 6'3", 225. I'm going to go 235, 240. He's a big boy. And they're happy to have him back because he is a powerful runner. They missed him when he was working his way back from injury.
35 career rushing touchdowns for Taylor. Quick set for White, and he missed his mark. Third down. Coxey matched up with the freshman Ahmad Gardner, who really stood out on tape to the Memphis offensive staff. If Memphis wins this game, these two teams are back here in a week's time in the American Conference Championship. Incomplete. Brady White had his receiver trip out of the break, and Perry Young was closest to it. So fourth down, and the rare Memphis field goal coming.
And a good stop by Cincinnati after the way that drive began. You know, that looked like that was going to be another 7 points. The defense made a tough stand in there, so now they have a chance to keep this within range.
Riley Patterson knocks it through from 34. Memphis by 14. We'll be back in exactly 1 minute. Tomorrow night, Joe Burrow got to be the front runner for the Heisman, right? Trying to stay perfect with LSU against Texas A&M, 7 Eastern time. This game was so good last year, they changed the overtime rules because of it.
You trying to influence the Heisman voters?
I'm not even trying. I'm doing it. Moment to moment. Am I influencing you? You saw the stats there. I mean, that's darn good. 79%. Montgomery on the return. Is it a runaway right now for Joe Burrow? And more post-play stuff going on.
More chippiness. Look, you have to be happy for Joe Burrow.
Yeah.
I mean, for what he's done after transferring from Ohio State and, you know, almost single-handedly bringing back the offense and passing attack with LSU. He's had a bigger impact than probably anybody else in the game right now.
I think Chase Young's the best player in college football, but Joe Burrow is a runaway Heisman winner.
I agree about Chase Young.
He demolished Penn State. I mean, he did it basically by his lonesome on that defensive side. Bryant, the freshman, cocks the arm for Pierce down the sideline, incomplete with Clay Brooks on him. Second down.
Well, they'll come back to that because Pierce was out there. Pierce had beaten Clay Brooks. And that ball, if it comes out a little bit sooner, a little bit farther, and you let Pierce run underneath it, you got something. But you can see that Bryant has some arm talent, right?
That's why they're throwing these passes downfield.
Yeah. Now, the problem you have to face is these first and second down run blitzes that they've been getting.
They'll roll them out this time. A little bit high, so no catch and run for Pierce. Clay Brooks got him. Third down, Cincinnati. And you feel like this is a big third down early in the game.
Yeah, just because, you know, your defense has finally given you a stop. If you're Cincinnati, you'd like for them to be on the sideline and kind of get their adjustments done. So you got to pick up this first down here. And to me, that means find your tight end. DeGuara is the guy that in key situations like this has been productive.
He's at the bottom of the formation.
Yep, he's right there. You can move him around.
And they do. So he breaks off and splits out wide. Bryant looking the other way. And on target right at the 50 for Rashad Medeiros. That's a nice ball down the sideline.
What a throw. What a throw. Look at this confident throw. Steps into it, and he gives the ball enough air to give Medeiros a chance to go get it. Nice route by Medeiros, leaving a lot of sideline over there for that ball to be dropped in.
Took a little bit off.
Yep.
To make it go on a gain of 29. Jared Doakes, who the defensive coordinator Adam Fuller called the best number two tailback in the American Conference. Former leading rusher for Cincinnati a couple years ago.
See the pace? Cincinnati slowing it down, not getting caught up in a relay race with Memphis.
Give the defense a little time to think. Pierce inside the 40, Cincinnati first down.
Like this adjustment. I like this plan. Cincinnati's using early down throws, first down, second down, getting away from trying to run against those run blitzes where they weren't getting anything.
Staying away from second and long.
Yep.
Or trying to at the very least.
Yep. Help the youngster out a bit.
Dopes. Carves inside the 30. Nice run and a big hole on the right side of that line. They got the hockey enforcer at the right guard spot, Morgan James, a 29-year-old former pro hockey player.
Drop the gloves.
That's a grown man you're talking about, 29.
Bryant keeps, and he loses a yard and a half. If Memphis wins,
that's the end of the first quarter.
The Tigers will once again be in the American Conference Championship game, but they won't be going to Orlando. They'll be hosting it here, lot on the line. College football returns after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
ESPN, home of the New Year's Six and the college football playoff.
Welcome back to ABC College Football, presented by TrackPhone. You saw the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic on our New Year's Six graphic. That's the game that the top group of five team will go to. Cincinnati and Memphis, the two top-ranked group of five teams right now.
Don't forget about Boise.
Don't forget at number 20, Boise State's out there as well. As this goes to the outside and Medeiros. But this is extra important for Cincinnati and Memphis if they both get to the American Championship game, because the American Conference doesn't have a specific bowl tie-in for their non-New Year's Six champion if that were to happen.
That's right. That's right. And Memphis, if they don't win today, they're done.
Yeah,
they're out. They need this game. And Cincinnati, at the very least, they can come back next week and play them again.
Unless somehow Navy ends up losing. But Navy's playing some really good football right now. Their only loss to Memphis, as Doakes is dumped at the 14-yard line.
Well, again, the first down run by Cincy, not very effective when Memphis keeps rolling out the run blitzes to deal with that. So now your freshman quarterback has a second and long. Can he handle the pressure? There will be pressure brought this time.
And he came in having thrown all of 20 collegiate passes.
Yep. Yep.
He got hit as he threw, and a flag comes down against Londre Thomas, the redshirt sophomore safety.
Yeah, the pressure comes inside. You knew it was going to be inside by Memphis. They would bring that.
Defense number 12. Automatic first down.
The throw was effective.
Yeah, now Brian hangs in there with the pressure, takes the hit as he's falling down. And then on the other end, you've got Thomas with the pass interference with the hand in there.
Yeah, left hand, he hooked him around the hip.
Yeah, the hook is okay, Q, but once you start to turn, that's when the flag comes. Can't hook and turn, you can only hook.
First and goal. Doakes
crash down.
Now, strong play inside for Memphis. Their nose tackle. Is that Goodson in there?
Yeah,
hard to read these numbers.
Bryce Huff has been involved in the last two.
Yeah, so Huff is usually on the outside. They moved him down inside, and he used his quickness to get by the center. So what do you have here now on this second down? You've got an extra tight end here. How about a little wildcat?
Yeah, Bryant split out to the top of the formation.
Memphis is confused on defense, and Mike Norvell calls timeout.
He needed
Memphis
it badly.
Memphis takes its first time out of the half.
There's a player running in from the sideline late. So Cincinnati trying to wrap down the door, 17-3. Kevin, thank you. That's a big game for Boise State, certainly for the American Conference. Their highest ranked team would come if the same team won the next 2 weeks, this game and then the American Championship. As Bryant is split out wide, they'll go wildcat out of the timeout anyway. And Warren is drilled behind the line. Third and goal coming up.
Well, you have to believe at this point, this is two down territory.
You've got to keep up,
right? You can't kick a field goal. So if you don't get it here, fourth down, you have to go.
That was terrific defense, because the strength of the Cincinnati O-line is their center, Dakari Robinson, and the two guards.
They've got three tight ends in their queue, but I don't think they're going to be able to run this inside.
They miss Ritter around the goal line because he was such a great run threat at the quarterback position.
Saw him on the sideline signaling plays in, injured today. Quick throw, touchdown. Cincinnati's first score, Leonard Taylor, the tight end. Number 5 on the depth chart, number 1 in their hearts.
6'5", 250 pounds, just a quick little slant for him. And with that big body, once he's inside, you see a little bit of a pick there to keep guys outside, and it works. It's such an easy play to defend if you don't try and chase a guy through a pick and you simply pass him off, but Memphis did not pass off.
Memphis's defense was great against USF last week. They allowed only 5 first downs. They've given up 8 today, and Cincinnati has some energy. The tight end room is partying. An 85-yard drive ends there, 17-10.
College football, presented by TrackPhone on ABC, is brought to you by Pacific Life. 150 years strong. Protection and retirement solutions for your future. Mercedes-Benz, the best or nothing. And Ice Cold Dr. Pepper. College football, presented by TrackPhone on ABC, is brought to you by Pacific Life. 150 years strong. Protection and retirement solutions for your future. Mercedes-Benz, the best or nothing. And Ice Cold Dr. Pepper, the official drink of Fansville.
They used to hoop it up in a pyramid around here, and now you can go shopping in a pyramid here on Black Friday. That's the Memphis bookstore.
Did you get your shopping in this morning?
I did barely any, and I'm not ready to do that either. They had all the Christmas decorations up in the Peabody Hotel. It's a little early.
Yeah.
But we have doorbuster offense so far here at the Liberty Bowl. 27 points in 17 minutes and change. Cincinnati just on the board. They use the tight ends well. And Memphis will have it as we take a look at today's track phone playbook.
Well, Memphis gets caught playing man-to-man coverage down here, and Cincinnati does just a nice little pick job. You see Huber 82 kind of run the pick there, then bring Taylor back inside, and you knock off a guy. Now, defensively, the adjustment for that is simply don't chase anybody. You pass off. If you're inside, you stay inside. If you're outside, you stay outside and take the guy who comes to you. There's an old rule in pass defense. When a guy goes in, another guy's coming out. If you just play it that way, someone's going to come to you.
What triggers that rule?
being knowledgeable, experienced, and talking to each other. You know, sometimes coaches can remind you of it, but you just have to know when you play with guys that you can do that.
Brady White, the quarterback, the Arizona State transfer. Gibson across the 30. Antonio Gibson, top 25 in the FBS in tackles broken. He's a receiver, but also a tailback.
Yeah, 6'2", 220, and he runs with a full head of steam, runs right through arm tackles. Yeah, you might think twice about trying to tackle that guy at full speed.
An accomplished special teams player now in this offense as well. They'll go the other way on the draw, and Taylor, it's a first down for Memphis. So many options explosively on this offense.
I'm telling you, that's why Mike Norvell is such a hot candidate for, you know, when jobs come open. No one's trying to run him out of Memphis, but people keep looking at him and his offense. He's only 38, and he's got this great offense, and people go, wow, he could change our program.
We asked him about the coaching stuff yesterday in our meeting on Thanksgiving, and he said, look, I've been offered a lot of jobs when I was working with Todd Graham. Every year I was there, I got offered a new job. I'm looking for the right spot if I am looking ever. Gibson to the outside, just roaming free to the 45-yard line.
Tell you, Gibson flashes on tape every time you plug in this Memphis offense. There's number 14 making big plays. Averages more than 20 yards per reception. They can play him at the slot. They play him in the backfield. He's a JUCO, second-year JUCO player, but at 221, he's deceptively fast. I've never seen him caught from behind. He's returned kickoffs for touchdowns.
White over the top, and his receiver not getting the head around. Gardner with the coverage on Jones.
And Q was talking about Gibson. How about the game Gibson had against SMU? I mean, he scored every way you can.
And there's a one run on tape where he basically runs through the entire Pony Express 2.0.
Yeah. A catch, a run, a special teams kick return.
He's an NFL prospect, Rod. The question is where? What position?
Anywhere he wants to play, Q.
Gainwell. Mining for a couple of yards. Third down coming up for Memphis.
I feel a little bit like Cincinnati has weathered the storm a little bit.
Especially if they get a stop here.
Mm-hmm.
There's a little bit of a malaise that has come over Memphis.
I wonder if Memphis realizes that their defense may not be up to the task, and they're just slowing things down here. Keep in mind, Cincinnati's 10-1 for a reason. They've had a lot of close wins, a lot of comeback wins. Luke Fickell said it's hard to beat a bunch of winners, and they are winners.
Pressure coming, and they got there. Perry Young from the outside sacks Brady White.
That's a huge third down stop. Young, the linebacker, comes from the edge unblocked. Usually Memphis has a tight end to help on the edge, not that time, and Young looped around, came off clean. Wow, big stop.
Quint talked about the win streak. Cincinnati winning 9 in a row, the fourth longest current active win streak in the nation, dating back to their loss to Ohio State back in September. Adam Williams punting to Ryan Montgomery on the first Memphis punt of the afternoon. There's a flag down as that ball checks up. Let's check the marker. It'll be the sixth penalty if accepted.
Legal formation, the kicking team, 5 men in the backfield. It's a 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
They're going to punt it again. So we mentioned this being the first punt for Memphis. Adam Williams, the punter, would be 12th in the country in average, but he doesn't qualify because he doesn't punt enough. The plight of the Memphis punter, he's never going to show up on a leaderboard because he doesn't do his job enough.
he gets to blame the offense for that.
Be careful with this Cincinnati punt coverage group, this punt block team. They've blocked 4 this year.
Yeah, they're really good coming off the edge, Q, bottom right. They do a really nice job.
19 Ethan Tuckey, who's in motion there, has been involved in three of those.
Yeah, they move him around a lot. He started on the right, now he's in the middle.
Here it comes, and they do get it away. It bounces inside the five and into the end zone. This week, Sunday NFL Countdown, 10 a.m. Eastern. The legend of Lamar Jackson, how it was born. Randy Moss's best catches from college football. And the top Turkey Bowl play from across the country. Monday Night Football, Seahawks and Vikings as well. 8 Eastern on ESPN. ESPN Deportes and the ESPN app. Coverage starts Monday Night Countdown at 6. We talked about DeGuara, the tight end for Cincinnati. His quarterback at Folsom High School in California was Jake Browning, who will be on the sideline in that game.
Wow.
On Monday night.
Yeah, they've had a good program at Folsom for quite a while.
Their senior year, they trailed once. Once all year. Bryant slings it, and he's been on target. Looks like he's settling in as he hits Geddes.
And I like what they're doing. They're giving him a chance to throw on first down when he's got better protection and can get the ball out and is not getting harassed. So much, much better adjustment by Cincinnati to get him going.
First career start for Ben Bryant. Memphis's run defense has been really stout at points today. It's third down.
They're not big enough to just sit in there and slug it out with Cincinnati, but they're quick, and they got a lot of guys that they can move around. So they like to use run blitzes on first down and second down to create this third down.
They've got 7 tackles for loss already.
Yep.
In a quarter and a half. Not even.
That's all quickness.
Warren keeps his feet and has the first down. We talked about how good he is after contact, and there's some skill there.
Yeah, breaking tackles. You're talking again about power versus quickness. Once he hits that hole inside, he runs through a lot of arm tackles. He's a powerful guy, 220 pounds. He was an excellent high school running back, but wasn't recruited by the big boys. Not Ohio State, not Michigan.
Out of Toledo Central Catholic. Another stop right at the line by Memphis. Johnson, the safety, got up there to cut him down.
Well, and that's the story. First down, run blitzes, get your safeties involved, create second and long. And now, how does Brian handle this? What does Fickell think? Are you going to let your quarterback take a shot throwing when you know second and long, they're going to give him some pressure?
Coming from the edge, he gets it away quickly, and that's incomplete. It was for Geddes. Clay Brooks knocked it free, and it's third down.
Now, I know you don't like this thought, what I'm about to say,
uh-oh,
but third down, I'd be conservative here. Draw, screen, something. I'm worried about a turnover if I'm Cincinnati putting my quarterback, you know, back to pass in this situation.
I don't mind it, the way your defense is played.
Okay, all right. Look,
we agree.
Yeah, I thought I was going to have to sell you more.
The birds are singing. The rainbows are across the horizon. Third down and 10 for Cincinnati.
Changing the play at the line.
Hey, they may show blitz and play coverage, Q.
And he goes to his wristband to change it up.
And you're going to get a timeout, Cincinnati.
Cincinnati takes its first timeout of the half.
Cincinnati trailing by 7. If Memphis wins, they go to the American Conference Championship next week. This season, Taco Bell is celebrating student sections and passionate fans like these by awarding the Liv Moss Student Section of the Year. Memphis Tigers Student Section on the national watch list. Go to ESPN.com/Taco Bell to see how your school can compete or get the committee's attention by using hashtag Liv Moss Student Section Contest. They are loud on 3rd and 10. Bryant slings it, and he's got the tight end to DeGuara for a Cincinnati first down.
Nice job. Memphis tried to disguise the coverage with Johnson. Watch him come down late to try and cover the tight end. They're too late. That's the problem, trying to hold your disguise too long, and the freshman quarterback recognizing it and delivering the ball.
He's challenging some Brent Celek records here in Cincinnati. And another rush play that goes for a loss, number 7 today for Memphis' D, Kevin Negandhi. Type of big play we haven't seen a whole lot of from Washington.
Have you figured out the Washington Huskies yet?
Nobody in America, I don't think, has. They have a very talented team.
It's the best 5 lost team in America.
Offense, number 52. It's a 5-yard penalty, second down.
To center Robinson with the penalty. Cincinnati's already in the American Conference championship game. They are unbeaten in the league. Memphis gets there with a win or a loss and a Navy loss tomorrow. And they're playing with their backup quarterback, Ben Bryant, for Cincinnati in his first career collegiate start. Screen it out for Warren, who gets the penalty yardage back and goes head over heels.
And if you're Cincinnati, you want to win this game for a couple of reasons. One, you want to get to that Cotton Bowl. A second loss would probably eliminate you. Two, if you beat Memphis, you don't have to deal with them again next week. And this is a tough team and an explosive team to deal with. So you'd like to get them out of the way if you could. So there's a lot of motivation for Cincinnati other than saying, we got this, we're in the championship game next week.
Cincinnati just converted a 3rd and 10. This is 3rd and 11. Bryant lets it rip again. DeGuara one more time, and he's got a Cincinnati first down. There was nobody near him.
No, he is the guy, and he's the one that they trust when they need something. And for whatever reason, Memphis has not paid close attention to him. There he is in the middle of the field with a lot of room working against a linebacker, and again, he picks up the first down.
Hard to believe, really. DeGuara is a Senior Bowl invite. He's their security blanket. She said he leads the team with 30-plus receptions.
Comes out for this run. Warren following the quarterback, Bryant, who gave a little bit more than a token block. And it's second down and medium.
Really nice job by Warren. But Q, going back to your point, you know, defensive philosophy is, you know, pretty straightforward. You find the best players and you take them away from the offense. You find their best plays and you take those away and make them do other things. And Memphis has not done that with the tight end. DeGuara, he's their guy in third down and passing situations, and he's literally been wide open.
He had no catches against Temple in the last game, so you figured they were going to try and get him on track today. As Geddes is out of bounds with another first down, and Cincinnati, remember, took the opening uppercut on that opening kickoff touchdown, but they do get the ball out of halftime.
Things have settled down. There was a huge storm by Memphis. A 94-yard kick return, big offensive plays and explosion, and Cincinnati just hung in there, and now you feel the momentum shifting to the Bearcats.
Long drives all afternoon for Cincinnati. This another one. One more slant. Oh, on the money to Jayshon Jackson. That was a howitzer.
He had no choice but to catch that one because Bryant put that one on the money with a lot of mustard on it. Look at that. I think it's right there. And that was in the teeth of pressure coming inside. He did not flinch. Bryant just let it fly.
Memphis playing without their top corner, DJ Carter, who's carried off earlier. And I think it's impacted their coverage of the slot receivers.
Bryant. On the run, you thought maybe they would lose some of that quarterback run game with Ritter out.
Yeah, and they really don't want to run him an awful lot, you know, because you've got injuries there with Ritter, but that one was too good to pass up for him.
Warren is in, touchdown. What a drive from Cincinnati.
that left side of the line, really powerful. Harper moved inside at the left guard spot, got a nice block inside, and then all you see at the end is Warren's strong leg drive. But that left side of the line, remember, we told you, this is a big, powerful, run-oriented offensive line, better at that than pass protection.
How about Warren getting low and muscling in back-to-back touchdown drives of 85 and 80 yards for the Bearcats, turning it into a chariot race to much success. This season, for every field goal and extra point made by participating universities, Allstate will make a contribution to the university's general scholarship fund. Thank you, Allstate. Oh, we got a game here at the Liberty Bowl. We're tied at 17. Warren with the touchdown for Cincinnati and another lengthy drive for these Bearcats, who have won 9 in a row behind their freshman quarterback, the redshirt in his first career start, Ben Bryant. Jones the kickoff. It has been treacherous. They get a fair catch this time. Time for our hardest working player, brought to you by Duluth Trading Company.
Have a day for yourself, Brian. You start it off, you get the butterflies knocked out of you with the sack, come right back, show that arm strength on the long out, and then a dart over the middle to your tight end, and then how about another fine throw to the edge there. This young man has settled in after, you know, the early start, getting a little bit of a hit there, and he's looking like he's been a quarterback all season long. But
you see the regular starter Ritter right there with him,
yep,
talking it over with him, wearing number 9 behind them.
130 yards passing already for Bryant. The last couple of weeks, they couldn't get over 100 yards passing.
A 62 last week against Temple. Just the 21st play for Memphis compared to 40 for Cincinnati. And DeMonte Coxey, the leading receiver, has a first down for the Tigers.
Feels like it's been quite a while since we've seen the Memphis offense. An 11-play drive will do that, huh?
It's amazing, Rod, to say, with how quickly they go, they actually lead their opponents in time of possession this year. And this one is dropped by Coxey. Gardner, yeah, on the coverage.
Yeah, they've had a few drops this season. Perfectly thrown ball. Coxey dropped that one. You know, as we went back and watched tape, there seemed to be 2 or 3 drops a game holding this offense back a little bit, but not that much since they've been regularly getting more than 40 points a game.
Yeah, 42 in 5 straight games. There goes Gainwell out of the backfield. White down the seam. He's got a completion inside the 30. Coxey finally tackled just before the 10 by Perry Young on a gain of 54. He looked at him after the drop, said, "Give it right back to me," and he did.
Yeah, matchup problem. They had Coxey on Young, a linebacker. And White recognized that right away and dropped it in over him. You cannot ask a linebacker to cover that wide receiver.
First down and goal, empty. Coxey down at the bottom. He's been the main target on the drive. White gets about a yard. How about that, though, for the quarterback, Brady White, who's tried to build his rapport with the receivers. Coxey looked at him, said, "I got you,"
yep,
essentially, after the drop. And this happened.
Yeah, yeah. Come right back to the guy after he drops one, and he says, "I'll make up for it." And boy, did he with that. Perfectly thrown ball, but nice, soft hands and some good yards after the catch for Coxey.
He's got a catch in 31 straight games. Now Taylor and Gibson both in the backfield. They motion Gibson, and this is overthrown, incomplete. Third and goal for Memphis.
Coverage by Bryant. They've been trying to work on him, and Bryant has had some really good games, and he's had some games where he's been targeted, and clearly Memphis came into this one thinking, if we get a chance, we want to target him, but he held up that time.
Third
on third and goal. Incomplete. Gardner locked up with Coxey.
Yep.
Very talented freshman corner, Gardner.
Yeah, that's the wrong way to go. You know, Gardner is 6'2", 6'2 and a half, long arms, and in press coverage over there, he's able to get his hands on Coxey and really wipe out that fade route.
Field goals are wins for the Cincinnati defense. It's been excellent in the red zone this year.
Ninth in red zone touchdown percentage against at 44%. As Patterson from 28 sticks it to give Memphis the lead. Tigers by three. We're back in 30 seconds. Coming up, stay tuned for our Capital One halftime report. Kevin DeGondi, Jonathan Vilma, Mark Sanchez have scores and highlights from around college football right here on ABC. A wahoo wah earlier in our first game, Virginia over Virginia Tech. It had been a long while since that game meant that much, and the Cavaliers will go to the ACC championship to take on Clemson.
Oh joy.
Oh yeah.
That's
good luck.
That's your prize.
Yeah. We'll gift wrap it for you. Let's take a look at our college football playoff rankings brought to you by PlayStation. What stands out to you?
A mild surprise that Ohio State jumped up to number one over LSU's nice resume, but I test for the committee saying that they think that's the most complete team in the country. I think Ohio State will stay at number one throughout, which means that we're likely to see LSU and Clemson in a semifinal playoff game if all things go as projected.
You could fit about 200,000 people into that game if you had a big enough stadium,
yeah.
You feel like.
Yeah, but that fourth spot is still up for grabs.
Alabama's still in the running. Utah's got a tough game against Colorado coming up tomorrow. Ben Bryant on the move, and he gets hit as he slides.
I just wonder if Utah's non-conference schedule is going to hold them back as the committee does the fine comparison
Memphis
between teams.
Memphis takes the second timeout of the half. Your 30-second timeout. Please reset the game clock to 1 minute 15 seconds. 1-1-5.
That is an interesting timeout called by Memphis. Cincinnati holding on to the ball. Past the top 10, though, you have these top group of five teams, and we might even be talking about Memphis, about the college football playoff had they not had that two-point loss to Temple. I know I shocked you with that, did have that one loss, so yeah. It does count.
It's so hard for a group of five team, even undefeated, as we've seen with Central Florida, actually get into the playoffs. So I think the real discussion for the group of five is really going to be about the New Year's Six game, and the others will continue to fight for that playoff spot, with all due respect to undefeated group of five teams.
We would be having the discussion. It's not like it would go anywhere necessarily, but the discussion would be had.
We've had it in the past.
We have.
With UCF.
Yeah. Bryant to throw. And nice defense by Memphis on Medeiros to set up a third down. Again, these are the two most highly ranked group of five teams right now as Memphis uses another timeout. 18 and 19, Boise State is 20. Appalachian State is 25. And the American Conference has had very good success in the New Year's Six since the college football playoff has gotten underway. The American in New Year's Six games, you remember Houston beating Florida State, Tom Herman's team 38-24 in the Peach Bowl. UCF in 2017 over Auburn, really trumpeting itself as a contender. And then, even without Mackenzie Milton last year, puts up an 8-point spread in the loss to LSU in the Fiesta Bowl. So, it's time for our Aflac trivia question. We teased it earlier with the Ducks and the Peabody.
Aflac.
And the CFP era, the group of five representative in the New Year's Six, has been from the American three times. Who were the teams the other 2 years?
Good question.
I wrote it myself.
And an interesting argument from the commissioner of the AAC the other day saying, look, if we have a two-loss champion, that team deserves to be in the New Year's Six Cotton Bowl, considering how tough our conference is.
Both coaches talked about the depth of the American Conference as we were getting ready for this game today.
Wow.
A run that goes absolutely nowhere. I mean, there were four Memphis jerseys. Bryce Huff was first.
Yeah,
clock moving.
This is just Huff using that quickness we talked about. This line, not big, but look how quickly he gets inside of Mets number 51. Just pure quickness to get in there, and another tackle for loss for this Memphis defense.
Smart clock management, too, by Mike Norvell there, using his timeouts to force this punt to get another possession.
You might as well, when you're the most efficient special teams team in the country.
Yeah.
Force the other team to do something on special teams. Play clock is going to get down to one, and Cincinnati will use a timeout.
Cincinnati takes its second timeout of the half. It'll be a 30-second timeout.
While we have a moment, why don't
Please
we answer
the game clock to
our Aflac
seconds.
Trivia
Zero,
question.
Two, six.
You had time
Thank
to
you.
Think about it or Google it or whatever you did. Here are the answers. The other two teams, Boise State 2014, and then Row the Boat 2016,
Row
Western
boat.
Michigan.
Yep.
Corey
yep.
Davis.
I had forgotten about Boise State. How could you? But I remembered Western Michigan. What do you think of that argument by the commissioner of the AAC, two lost teams? I don't think the committee is going to buy that. I think they're going to look at whoever is the one lost team out of the group of five.
Yeah, I would agree, especially with the year App State has had and Boise State if they win the Mountain West Championship. Yes, but if we're not talking about wins, losses, lost numbers being that important in the college football playoff era, you can make the argument and sleep at night, certainly. A strong argument as it goes rolling inside the 25 on the punt, and Cincinnati will let the clock operator wait as long as possible to push stop. It is a strong Cincinnati, Memphis, UCF, Navy, SMU at the top of the American.
Well, you know what the committee says.
What's that?
They don't look at conferences. They look at teams.
Okay.
And that
teams
argument.
Teams do play in conferences.
I'm not saying I buy the argument.
I know.
that's their rationale weekly. And the argument would be, let us compare Boise State, assuming they went out, with one loss versus a two-loss champ. And we've seen nothing from the committee to have any tolerance so far for two-loss teams in premier games.
Brady White was going to sprint out and throw here, and there's a flag down.
False start. Offense. Number 67, 5-yard penalty, first down.
You hate that when you got something in the playbook that you're going to mess around with and then a flag stops it.
And now I'd be shocked if they were aggressive. Mike Norvell taking off the headset is kind of a sign that they're going to take a knee and go to the locker room.
I mean, you've been working on it for all of 12 weeks. Get the chance, and now have to put it back in your pocket. What we know is we have two top 20 teams, strong teams, trying to get to the American Conference Championship. Memphis would do it with a win. Cincinnati's already there. And the Tigers lead by three at halftime. Memphis took a big lead early, opening kickoff to the end zone. Cincinnati has stormed back very well as Norvell is going to give his halftime speech prelude on the field. 20-17. When we return, the guys in the studio take over after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
Coach, what did you just emphasize with your team?
We just got to play clean football. You know, we're giving up too many third downs, third down and long situations. Offensively, we got to stay on the field on third down. But I think we've been able to move the ball offensively. We just got to finish when we get in the red zone with touchdowns.
Yeah, the offense is fine. Your secondary seems to be having issues. What are those?
Well, you know, we lost TJ there earlier, so we're moving some guys around. But, you know, the biggest thing, I think we're playing well. We just have to get off the field. We're giving up too many third and long conversions. But I know our guys will respond.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
Welcome back to ABC College Football presented by TracFone. Lovely Memphis, the site of two top 20 teams, 20-17, Memphis with the lead. Your group of five, sometimes people talk like these are like cute teams or nice teams. These are more than very nice teams. They're very good teams. One of them very possibly is going to end up in the Goodyear Cotton Bowl class.
And we've seen in the past when they get to the Cotton Bowl, they hold their own in the New Year's Six game. So we've got this great race between Memphis, Cincinnati, and Boise State.
18, 19, and 20 in the college football playoff rankings. If Memphis wins, they go to the American Conference Championship. Cincinnati already has its bid. As we take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. Splash plays early.
Well, I don't know where you were if you missed all the big plays in the first half. Memphis had three plays over 30 yards. Gainwell showing you one there, and then Coxey with a big catch here. But Memphis also had a big play in the kick return game. But Cincinnati not to be denied. Ben Bryant, the freshman quarterback, great first half after, you know, getting knocked around the first couple plays. Comes back with a touchdown pass there to Taylor and had some nice throws to his other tight end, DeGuara.
That guy right next to him has been important too. Michael Warren II, the junior out of Toledo. 15 carries, 66 yards and a touchdown for him. Bryant uncorks and nearly intercepted by Clay Brooks. As we take a look at our first half stats brought to you by Bright House Financial. Ben Bryant, 14 for 19, first career start.
Now, keep in mind that Cincinnati struggled to throw the ball the last couple of weeks, and getting some passing has been real important and critical for them if they have any shot of getting to the Cotton Bowl, and he's provided them with some passing offense today.
Out of suburban Chicago, Bryant keeps it, third down, Quinn.
Yeah, for a game that couldn't have started any worse, the Bearcats and head coach Luke Fickell feeling pretty good about where they stand. One thing he mentioned to me, though, as you just saw, first down, look for some play action or perimeter runs. Meanwhile, for Memphis, it's all about third down defense. Right here, their secondary has really struggled in the first half, defending third and long situations. They lost a starting corner earlier in the ball game, and at times communication has been lacking.
Quinn, this is Lorenz Metz, the right tackle out of Germany, who is down. A major part of this offensive line, the youngest man on this line for Luke Fickell.
He's a big man at 6'9", 330 pounds. This is an offensive line that has a number of unique players, and once again, we've seen this earlier today, just getting rolled up from behind, causing an issue.
Metz is down. We'll be back in 1 minute.
Please reset the game clock to 14 minutes, 43 seconds. 1-4-4-3. We'll start on my signal. Thank you.
Third down after the injury. Bryant with a laser and it's incomplete. DeGuara, the intended target. And Thomas, the safety, was on him.
He had him again. I mean, that's the guy on third down. And he had him open again, but that one was a little bit too hot and a little bit behind him. I mean, if you're Cincinnati, you're thinking, we can still convert some third downs. You've seen nothing to show that they can take away their tight end, DeGuara.
Cincinnati.
That was a big stop by Memphis's defense, considering how good Cincinnati has been to start third quarters this year.
And considering how good that offense was at the end of the first half, that's what I was going to say. Long drives. They only had the 1 4-play drive that led to the punt. Everything else was pretty well sustained as Memphis gets it very quickly out of halftime for Brady White.
And Memphis has been all about the big play on offense. See if Cincinnati can sort of continue their ability to limit those big plays as they did late in the first half. But you got to be concerned on first down. They will take their shots.
We didn't see a lot of Kenny Gainwell in that first half. Just 5 carries, 46 yards. The freshman sensation is in the backfield as they pull from the left side, and Gainwell's got 3 on first down. We talked to him during the week, very humble young man out of Yazoo City, Mississippi, north of Jackson, about 3 hours south of here. May have seen the story on him on College Game Day a couple of weeks ago about his brother Curtis, who's been through quite a bit. Play action, it's the screen, and Cincinnati is right on it with Gainwell.
It's like Cincinnati expected it all along. And they had their linebackers sitting there waiting for it, and good pressure as well to kind of push that tempo there. Now, another third down. Can Cincinnati get off the field?
They run it on third down. So Cincinnati does hold the line on Gainwell. We saw him get a couple of looks on that drive, but Cincinnati was game.
That whole drive was Gainwell. Hand it to him, throw it to him, hand it to him. And Cincinnati expected it, and they shut down that third down play. A little surprising, Memphis didn't throw on third down.
With all that talent on the outside, it will be punt time for Adam Williams. Fair catch for Montgomery. So if you had 2 punts to open the second half, you're a very smart person. You're watching the American Conference on ESPN. First half saw 1 3-and-out combined. We have had 2 to start the second half. Has the offense gone away for the rest of the day? Likely not.
I wouldn't take that bet.
No. Cincinnati already going to the American Conference Championship. Trying to put itself in position for a New Year's 6 berth. A win would certainly help today.
This is the most diverse and unique offensive line I think I've ever seen. You've got a basketball player, a guy from the Bahamas who didn't play football for the longest, and a hockey player, not to mention a guy from Germany who's like 6'9" that just got banged up a little bit.
It's a holiday spirit, Rod. It's the island of misfit toys.
Bryant to throw. And he's got another wide open receiver, Alec Pierce. The line kept him upright. And here is that offensive line, including Metz, who has gone out of the ball game. Morgan James, you love his story. I mean, he was a professional hockey player. He was an enforcer. You got Ferguson, who first played football 6 years ago. Basketball player.
So you're taking unique guys, athletes, and teaching them to be offensive linemen so you can have dominant guys down the road.
Warren put it in reverse, then got it back into drive, and ends up with 3 yards on first down behind that line.
You can see what Luke Fickell is doing with his offensive line. He's looking for guys with the right body type. You know, maybe he can't get the guy that Ohio State gets, but he can find a body type, and then he can help coach up a guy to be a good offensive lineman.
That's right. They're projects. I mean, yep. Ferguson, 6th year, really didn't play much. 1 year of high school football.
Bryant intercepted. Jacoby Francis lost the ball back, and now
Hall says Memphis has it at the bottom of the pile, but there is treachery at the bottom of every scrum. We'll find out. It is Memphis football.
And Francis did a tremendous job coming back to pick off that ball. He was sitting in a short zone and just kept drifting and watching the quarterback's eyes. Brian never sees him. He just thinks, I got one guy to beat. But Francis was near the line of scrimmage, only about 5-7 yards deep, and kept watching and kept drifting.
Good job by DeGuara to strip it free, but it goes right back to Memphis, which has the first turnover of this ball game. Ritter talking it over with his understudy, Ben Bryant.
Oh, he'll learn from it. You have to know where those guys are that sneak around from various angles back there. Understand the coverage.
Memphis goes run, and Taylor gets hucked down to the ground by Brian Wright, the former high school quarterback, who is one of the leaders on this defense.
That was a tremendous play. Showed his quickness sneaking inside, and Memphis now finding itself in a second and long situation.
See Wright communicating there. He is the guy that helps get everyone in line. He passed it along to Gardner. Counter play for Taylor, and it's third down coming up as Gardner tried to rip it free.
Where is Gibson?
Yeah, he's not been terribly prevalent today in the offense.
No, and he's a guy that when you put him in a slot, you've got a matchup issue, and Memphis has not used him very much today in that position.
No, that's right. I think he's carried the ball two times as a running back, Rod, but now you see him top of your screen, the near slot man.
Yeah, right there, Q. He's in a good spot for a matchup.
Yeah, four total touches today for Gibson. Grady White under duress on the roll, and this to the sideline is incomplete. Marquand Bush, the freshman, with the coverage, and another punt on the way.
Well, if you're Cincinnati, you have to feel really good about what your defense is doing right now. I mean, you're getting that second and long look. There's a defensive coordinator, Marcus Freeman, who's got this team really playing at a high level defensively. After that first quarter, they weathered the storm, and right now you could say they kind of have control of the Memphis offense right now.
They seem to. That's what it looks like right now as a flag comes in before the punt.
And that's what the body language down here says.
False start. Kicking team number 7. 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
How so, Quint?
Well, the Bearcats are 10-1. They've won a lot of close games. They've won comeback games. They look comfortable right now. Memphis is more of a front-running team, you know, scoring at will, creating high-scoring games. They're not used to punting. And I think that's starting to show in terms of body language.
Saw Mike Norvell with his hands on his hips there. Williams punts it to Montgomery, and the freshman with a returnable kick. Montgomery finds his way just short of the 30-yard line. Net of 26 on the punt. Cincinnati ball when we come back. Close game here in Memphis as we take a look at today's biggest moments of the game, brought to you by Samsung QLED TV. If you missed the first play of the game, you missed a big thing.
Yeah, Chris Claybrook, 94 yards to open the game. That wasn't the only big play. We had some throws from Leonard, from Bryant, as that passing attack for Cincinnati came to life after a couple weeks of being dormant.
And Memphis's offense has been bogged down by Cincinnati defensively the last couple of drives out of the half. So Trey Tucker has checked into the game. They were looking to get him more carries. He's got great speed. And Tucker, who runs a 4.37 40, they say, has a first down.
I'm going to buy it.
Oh, man, how about that?
That quickness, I'm buying that number for him.
That's good coaching, too, because they've been stuffed all through this game, running on first down between the tackles, little perimeter run on first down with Tucker, the speedster, 21.
Q, the question, though, is how does Bryant react to his last throw, which was the pick? Does he settle in? Is he aggressive when they let him throw?
Yeah, let's look at that touchdown as they disguised it up front.
Well, it's a two-deep coverage, and watch the corner down at the bottom, Francis. What he does is he's got the lower flat, so he just decides, well, I'm going to keep my eyes open. I'm going to keep getting depth because I'm not being threatened, and he knows there's a number two receiver inside. Watches, picks. That is excellent two-deep coverage. Quarterbacks have to be aware of that, especially when you're a freshman and you just think it's a simple straight-up number two coverage. You got to be aware of it.
Well, there's the pick. Now Bryant unleashes to the sideline. And Doak sets up a third down.
And that's a good throw to get his confidence back. That's his first throw after the pick. So now he's seen the ball go to his receiver. Now on third down, if you need him, go back. And who are you looking for? Maybe 83, huh?
You would imagine he's been alone in points, DeGuara, this evening.
He's right there.
Part of the bunch on third down. Pressure got there. Bryant lost the ball. Memphis has it at the bottom of the pile. Wilson sprung it free.
Excellent job by Memphis defensively. Bryant wanted to go to DeGraw, his tight end, but he was doubled. So he had to pull it down, and he didn't put the ball away. Excellent job by Memphis getting in there, surrounding him, and forcing that ball out because he wanted to go to DeGuara right off the bat. Memphis finally doubled him in the middle of the field and took away that option.
Adam Fuller, the defensive coordinator, told us one of the things on his list for today was he needs more turnovers.
He's a really good defensive coordinator, too. I mean, he knows what he's doing. Freeman understands his defense has got to match what Memphis just did.
Gibson in the backfield along with Taylor. A big hitter in the run game for Gibson. There he is. Yes, where he was. Gibson's got a first down, gain of 18.
Yeah, they're going to go tempo and go fast here.
Now White, who sometimes does have a couple of plays, he'll check out a one. Taylor across the 20. Patrick Taylor Jr., just 20 career touchdowns behind the record of D'Angelo Williams here at Memphis, where they have had a lot of good running backs. Saw Tony Pollard last night for the Cowboys, Darrell Henderson for the Rams, who they lost after last year. Another run, and Taylor just bowling balls his way.
Pushing the pile. Again, he is a big, big running back.
Mike Norvell's the type of play caller. When he senses a weakness in the defense, he pokes at it and pokes at it. They often run repeater plays. As long as they're continuing to have success on the ground, they'll stay with it.
Run this one again, Q? Right back at it?
Why not?
Still nobody scored in the third quarter on a halftime.
Looks like he's going to have to call a timeout. Oh, he's not going to go over well.
No, he's been on the field trying to help them get lined up, and they were burning the clock.
Memphis takes its first time out of the half.
Mike Norvell frustrated. Third and one when we come back.
NFL Primetime is back. Primetime's available Sunday through Wednesday only on ESPN Plus.
As the kids say nowadays, okay, Boomer. Sunday through Wednesday, NFL Primetime on ESPN Plus. It is third and one out of the Memphis timeout.
Two tight ends on that right side down there. Heavy set there.
Taylor. Hit behind the line. Cincinnati gets there once again. Perry Young, that talented linebacker, the senior with a stop.
You kick it?
I think you go for it.
You always think you go for it.
Well, that's what the numbers typically say. I mean, a field goal might help you here. Cincinnati has not scored much here in the second half, but if you believe in your offense that's number 8 in scoring in the country, you go.
Yeah, well, I when you're the superior team, if you believe you are, you keep tacking on points, and they don't believe that right now.
White got a block from Taylor, and Brady White throws it to the sideline, incomplete.
Yeah, you get nothing out of it.
He came to the short side with a roll that way. Don't have many options, Rod.
I hear you. I'm just saying. I know what your analytics say, but when you are up and you got a chance to tack on points, keep momentum, do it.
That was great coverage by Derek Forrest, number 5.
Yeah.
Just hit step for step, hip on hip. He was in great position the entire play. Took a good angle. Nothing there. Tremendous defense.
Yeah, and Q, when the offensive play is called to the short side of the field, as a defensive back, you can play with a lot of confidence. There's not a lot of room, not a lot of places for the guy to go. So Memphis helped him out a little bit with that play call.
Cincinnati back on the ball. Bryant slams on the brakes and gets a couple of yards.
You know, I wouldn't run him. He throws it so well. I'd like to keep him healthy.
You got to keep him healthy because Ritter, the starter, didn't play today. That's why Bryant's in the first place. Here's Ritter. Warren, little hesitation, and he found a crease. Warren across the 50, and he's got a first down, Cincinnati. Such great vision for Michael Warren, the second.
Well, great blocking up front. Chris Ferguson, 75, gets in there and then gets to the linebacker. And that block on the linebacker is what really opened up the way for Warren to get going. So credit Chris Ferguson, 75, for the great block.
Michael Warren is the only 5'11 guy in sports I've ever heard say, I'm actually 5'10. He doesn't mind being the short guy. He got a lot of want to. He's talked about feeling overlooked in high school, didn't have the big time offers, but man, is he a good running back.
You know, a chip on your shoulder can do wonders for you. Gives you that drive, huh, Q?
Well, why doesn't he list himself at 5'9 then?
Well, right. I mean, be a scat pack. Be Darren Sproles if you want to.
I tell you, he leans on people, though. He gets better as the game goes on.
We told you about him after contact. Vicious numbers. DeGuara. Nice play. Bryant kept it alive and flipped it across the sideline. The tight end, DeGuara.
I think Bryant is starting to feel like this is no different than high school. I mean, that run pass option out there, he looked like the most confident guy in the world, waiting until the last minute to get rid of the ball. I mean, his confidence is pretty sky high right now.
See the B. Bryant on his jersey. The last game ever coached by Bear Bryant was in this very building, the 1982 Liberty Bowl. As Warren on the run, they've got to be having a watch party right now at Lyons Township High School, southwest of Chicago. They've got to have a big screen up or something like that.
Couple of them.
You have to
get a lot of folks in there.
Ben Bryant's first career start on LaGrange, Illinois. There you see the B. Bryant and the number 6 as a starter for the first time. Run it again, Warren.
This offensive line is wearing out that front. And we've talked about the size and that the quickness of Memphis is what helped them early on. Right now, the size of this interior offensive line is leaning on these guys and pounding them and having no trouble executing double team blocks and getting to the linebackers and providing holes for their running backs.
Saw the big German right tackle. Metz is back in the game across that mammoth line for Cincinnati, which has run 22 more plays than Memphis, leading to that fatigue you're talking about. Third down, Warren driving, pushed back, counter punching, and he's very close but just short.
Big boy football.
So Doakes just short of the line to gain, and it's fourth down and about half a yard. What
kick
are you doing?
It. Kick it, right? Kick it and tie the game. Nope.
You got nothing to lose if you're Cincy.
No, if you're Cincy, you know you're in the championship game and you want to.
All the pressure's on Memphis.
You want to be done with Memphis and not have to play them next week. I get it. But, hey, kick that field goal.
The New Year's 6 berth is in the balance. If you lose, you have much less of a chance. They're going for it. Fourth down, Warren back in, and he is stuffed. So Doak's got him a half yard short. Warren is stonewalled.
What is it with these coaches that don't like points?
Well, look, that one makes less sense. You're down three.
Each side has decided not to take gimme field goals. And so we're right where we were.
You know, there are two distinct decisions. Number one is, do you go for it? Number two, what are you calling?
Well, look, I understand the call because their offensive line has been winning up front. But give credit to Memphis because they're like, well, they're not going to do anything but run it at us. So you throw your run blitzes at them, you get more bodies in there, you use your quickness, and you get a stop. It can happen. It did happen.
So first down, Memphis. From inside the 20. Down the middle, White with some confidence to the 30-yard line, and Coxey. Gain of 13 from Brady White, who made a major impression on Mike Norvell all the way back to high school when he visited Arizona State, when the head coach was there running the quarterback room. Gainwell breaks a couple of tackles, but Norvell told us about Brady White. He brought him into a practice. The kid watched practice, came into the room with a yellow legal pad, and had all these notes written down, was diagramming plays, knew exactly what was going on.
Well, for Arizona State fans, you may recall Mike Berkovici was the quarterback, and so at a spring practice, this kid is in the room. He's taking more notes than Berkovici, and he's just getting started in high school.
Filled up 3 pages on his legal pad. Oh, my goodness, what a hit by Jarrell White.
And at that point, Norvell said, this kid is a unique quarterback. He's into it. He loves the game, and he's a smart guy. He's an accurate quarterback, and I think accuracy sometimes gets underrated by scouts and people who look at quarterbacks because they get enamored with the big arm. You give me a guy who can put the ball where it needs to be over a guy with the big arm any day.
Came in 67% on the year as Memphis has really spun its wheels on third down. White, little behind him, and that pops out. That's a fumble officially, and the ball ends up on the sideline. So Memphis does get a first down.
Did he actually have control of that?
The referees really let that one play out.
Which is the right thing to do, Q.
The ruling on the field is that the pass was caught and then fumbled forward and out of bounds. The ball replaced at the spot of the fumble. Play results in a first down.
And this can be a lot of things, Jason. This can be an incomplete pass. This can be a catch and a fumble.
Yeah, it's Calvin Austin who was tucking it away.
Previous plays
like
on a
catch
further review.
Down.
Since he left his feet, he has to complete the process.
Because he was going to the ground on the catch.
Correct.
Yes.
And that didn't look to me like he completed the process. Remember, you need indisputable video evidence to overturn the call on the field. And that first look we had looks to me, process not completed. He loses the ball on contact. He's got to control that through contact with the ground. That's an incomplete pass in my book.
Such a difficult call to legislate live, first of all.
It's the right call on the field. The officials made the right call. You let this play out.
Right, no, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. But again, remember what's at stake here. If it's incomplete, this is going to be fourth down, Memphis. If it is complete and a fumble, Memphis has a first down, right, and the drive will continue. This is a huge review in this game. So the call is catch, fumble, and first down, Memphis.
I don't see any way that was a fumble, because even if he caught it, then the ground caused the ball to pop loose.
Well, but you do have to have indisputable video evidence to overturn, so that's why you'd argue
for leaving it as it is?
Yeah, I would say stands you could argue for,
yeah,
just because his elbow's down.
After further review, the pass was complete. However, the runner was down before the ball became loose. The first down for Memphis at the 41-yard line. Cruiser set the game clock to 40 seconds, 0-4-0, and they'll start on my signal.
I find that surprising.
Yeah, based on the rule, based on leaving your feet and going to the ground, that junction point that the officials have to deal with, absolutely. But there's also the part of what was the call on the field. Do you have enough evidence to overturn? And
yep.
That seems to be what they're relying on in this case. So, catch, no fumble. First down for Memphis. And they will run it to absolutely no avail. Curtis Brooks, the big defensive lineman, squashed that play with Gibson, and it's second down and long. Memphis will try and run one more play before the end of the third quarter, a scoreless third quarter so far. With 3 seconds, Brady White will end the quarter, awaiting a snap.
The third quarter.
20-17, college football returns after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Two top 20 teams as we take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. It's gone quiet in the third quarter. No scoring after 20-17 at halftime. And Ben Bryant, his first career start, 158 yards and a touchdown despite some long chains.
Yeah, and give a lot of credit to that Cincinnati defense that, you know, got pushed around the field in the first half early on. They've kind of settled in and kind of held Memphis in check after that.
They've only had to play 43 total snaps. This is the 44th, and a slant from White has a first down for Coxey against Gardner. DeMonte Coxey, who Cincinnati defensive coordinator Marcus Freeman said it comes through the tape how competitive he is. They're going to mark him just short of the first down. That is a rough spot for Coxey, and White does get the first down. Rod, I thought for sure he was well across the line to gain. They're going to get it anyway.
Yeah, no harm. They picked it up. But the matchup that Cincy wants with Coxey is that they want Gardner, the freshman, on him because he's similar in size and has those long arms. But when they get Coxey on someone else, Memphis tries to go that way.
That was on Cam Jeffries. You just saw number 14 in white. Brady White slings it out wide and has a short gain on first down.
Cincinnati's tackling has been excellent, Jason. When you think about this Memphis offense and so many of their explosive plays are just one-on-ones. Guys shake loose, they break a tackle, and they're gone. But something to watch now as Cincinnati gets tired defensively. Can they keep tackling effectively?
They got Magnifico with the first guy in there on a gain of three.
Heavy formation into the boundary, short side, couple tight ends on balanced formation.
Taylor reverse, back to White. He loads it up, down the middle of the field. Touchdown! DeMonte Coxey brought it in.
Little triggeration. They put the formation into the boundary and got all the Cincinnati players over there, totally confusing them. Single coverage down the field for the end of the triggeration. And we talked about Coxey, 6'3", and his leaping ability. Goes up and makes that play.
You said it, when he's on somebody else or going that way. It was against Cam Jeffries, who's at 5'10".
Yep.
Coxey with a touchdown. Memphis with a 10-point lead. some Memphis chicanery here.
Yeah, you got Coxie, the receiver, matched up against Cam Jeffries. The safeties get caught up in the trickeration. They pay no attention to the pass because formation into the boundary, fake it to the wide field. Look at the safeties. They're all caught up with the run play and the fake. So no help down the field for Jeffries, who is much smaller, much shorter than Coxie. Coxie just goes up and picks up the ball. A very well-designed play.
He's just the third 1,000-yard receiver in Memphis history, and Brady White with his 11th consecutive game with at least two touchdowns, as Cincinnati will get it at the 25. For a Boise State update, here's Kevin Negatti. Huge news for the American Conference. If Boise State takes a loss, the American has a better shot of withstanding a loss by each of its teams in the top 25 if that were to happen.
That's
and
right.
Staying in the New Year's Six.
That's right.
Bryant, the freshman, unloads into double coverage and incomplete. Jayshon Jackson was bracketed.
Just a reminder of what's at stake here, whether you're talking Boise State, Memphis, or Cincinnati. They are all vying for a spot in the Cotton Bowl as the top group of five team.
Cincinnati and Memphis, the top two group of five teams as it stands right now. And one loss apiece to Ohio State and Temple. There you see what's on the line for both these teams. Cincinnati already in the American Conference Championship game. Memphis trying to get there for the third straight year. They do it with a win.
And as we talked about earlier, if Cincinnati loses this game, they will play for the championship next week against Memphis, but it likely takes them completely out of the Cotton Bowl race.
Depending on what happens with Boise State and with Appalachian State, certainly, as App plays at Troy this weekend. Third down and four, Cincinnati.
Where's your tight end? Where's 83? Right there.
Brian looking that way. Instead, he goes shorter and has the first down to Doak. So they go double tight end. They throw that direction, and it's first down Cincinnati.
A well-designed play, giving your quarterback a read to that side with your quarterback, with your running back out of the backfield, who has good hands, picks up the key first down. Still alive, still moving in this.
All three timeouts left for Cincinnati. Dokes through the car wash for a rugged yard.
Mike Denbrock, Cincinnati offensive coordinator, just yards away from me, far side left 25 right now, saying, let's go, let's go. He wants this group to operate with a little more rhythm and a little more tempo. He's getting on his signal, guys, to get the calls in faster.
Yeah. First down run blitz got him that time, Q. See if they get pressure again on second down.
With the coverage backing off, Bryant tried to unload. The ball springs free, and it ends up on the sideline, rescued at the edge by Hoff into the arms of J.J. Russell. And now let's see what the call is. Did that hit the sideline before it was recovered?
Was it a fumble,
first of all,
or an incomplete pass, an attempted pass?
Let's see.
Ruling on the field is a fumble recovered by Memphis. That plays under further review.
2 points here. Number one, as you said, fumble or pass. Number two, was the ball recovered before it went out of bounds? A lot to maze through. We'll do it for you when we come back. lot to sort out on this play as we'll take a look at it. The call on the field is Memphis recovery. That likely will not stand. First fumble or not?
Yeah, this is a fumble. Watch Huff 55 get his hand on the football as he makes the tackle. Now on the sideline, this is your first touching out of bounds by Russell, by Hall. He touched it twice out of bounds, so there's no control by Memphis. That ought to be a Cincinnati recovery of its own fumble.
Let's see.
Okay. I wasn't afraid to take the chance. See if I could pass the quiz.
That was a multi-part test. That's multi-variable calculus going on. Luke Fickell, who's done an outstanding job with his Cincinnati program, double-figure wins the last 2 years.
Replay looked at two components to the play. Ruling on the field of a fumble has been confirmed. However, number 38 of the defense was out of bounds when he touched the ball. Therefore, it'll be Cincinnati's ball, third down at the 33-yard line. The game clock will start on my signal.
Yeah, the crowd's booing, but that's the right call. Yeah. Well sorted out by instant replay.
Look, this crew has been on top of it all game, including some difficult situations where you've had to let a fumble play out. They've let it play out and let the ruling get squared away with replay. So I think they've had a really good night.
It's a third down and a long third and 15 as they stand here in Memphis. Bryant slings it, and he's got it. Pierce inside the 20-yard line. Alec Pierce, a big rip for Cincinnati for 51.
This is just pure speed. Watch him just run by the deep defender. That should never happen. You're supposed to be deep is the deepest, wide is the widest. He just ran right by him. Good job by Pierce with his speed.
He says his favorite thing to do is run downfield routes. He did right there. And it's first down Cincinnati. They turn to Dokes.
So if you're Adam Fuller, the defensive coordinator, you're pulling your hair out. You're going, wait a minute. I called a coverage to keep the ball in front, and they still get behind us?
If he had hair, he'd be pulling it.
That's true. Bryant, touchdown! Keep that ball, young man. His first on the ground. And Cincinnati is within one score.
This is the zone read, which is a staple of their offense, but they haven't run it much today because Ritter, the normal quarterback, is good at it. They don't want Bryant to do this very often, but he completely fooled the defensive end on that side from Memphis, had a stroll into the end zone.
Cincinnati's won 9 in a row, the fourth longest winning streak in the nation. Alec Pierce got him close. It's a 3-point game.
College football on ABC is presented by TrackPhone, the new TrackPhone wireless. Now you're in control. In part by Pacific Life, 150 years strong. Protection and retirement solutions for your future. And Jiffy Lube. You can do more in a jiffy.
Our version of holiday cheer here in Memphis is lots of points and maybe a final possession football game.
Can you kick to either one of these guys?
You know, they wouldn't have, and it's led to fair catches. We saw Claybrook score on the opening kickoff. Here he is again, and he gets crunched at the 19-yard line. Kevin Nagati in the studio. Boise State lurking for that New Year's 6 spot for the group of 5.
I tell you, that race for that spot, that's great now, and it's not going to end until the last championship game.
It makes you think there might maybe need to be more than one spot.
You will just not give up on trying to get the group of 5-6 spots.
These are very good teams that don't get as much of a chance as they should to be seen. Brady White over the top, nearly intercepted by Kobe Bryant.
I will agree with you about that. You know, you can make an argument about the American Conference being as strong or stronger than the ACC,
yep,
minus Clemson.
Clemson obviously would be the class, yeah, of the leagues combined, yeah, but you talk about wins in the non-conference, you talk, yep, about scoring margin teams.
You can make that argument, and you would not be crazy.
Two very good football teams this Thanksgiving Friday. Cincinnati brings some heat, and they'll go shovel pass. Gainwell tripped up.
Great job, Brian Wright. He didn't buy anything. He stood right there, read the play, waited, and said, ah, look what's coming my way. Big third down.
It's a tough call for Coach Norville here.
A third down and eight. Where do you go?
Well, the place they would like to work is on the outside, but they want to stay away from Gardner 12. But Gardner, the corner, is in the short side of the field, and that's your man-to-man matchup. You might have to go that way.
No safety that direction. White climbing the pocket. White tucks it and runs. He seeks the first down and got it, but there's a marker in.
Yeah, that marker is going to be on Gardner. He was matched up with Coxey. You know, White wanted Coxey in that one-to-one matchup.
Well, that's Wright that's down. Brian Wright, the grad student from the state of Ohio, who just made the beautiful play on the screen, reaching for his back.
Holding. Defense number 12. 10-yard penalty. He added on to the end of the run. First down.
Goes on Gardner.
Well, here's your holding call on Gardner. He's got Coxey, and you see him, he's riding him and grabbing him. But that was the man-to-man coverage where White wanted to go, and when he didn't see it, he decided to take off. As you see, that's where Wright got injured.
Yeah, lower back, as you said, Delaware native. He is a key to this defense in the middle.
Hey, Kevin in the studio, what you got? It had been a long, 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 long time,
yeah,
since Virginia won one of those games.
Bryce Perkins, good friends with Brady White.
Yeah, and then Arizona
former
State.
Teammates.
Yeah, quarterback room together. Gainwell finally breaks one in the second half and just tripped up by Forrest.
His lateral movement, man, really something. That play was designed to go inside. He feels it to the outside. Watch the lateral movement right there. Just the sidestep to get outside and pick up that yardage.
He is fourth in the nation in all-purpose yards. Quiet, humble young man out of the state of Mississippi. He has not busted much in the way of big plays today.
Well, they haven't gone to him as much as we sort of expected for a guy who came in to tonight's game with 1,300 yards rushing.
Gainwell shimmying and keeping his feet, but a marker is down again. We'll check the flag. Hey, tomorrow, Minnesota, Wisconsin, 3:30 on ABC.
77. It's a 10-yard penalty, first down.
You talk about it, been a while. Minnesota finally reclaimed Paul Bunyan's axe last year in Madison and basically ran all the way around Camp Randall with it until they told him to go home. And that was essentially the trampoline for P.J. Fleck team to do what they've done this season.
How about the job P.J. Fleck has done at Minnesota? He did it at Western Michigan. And so at some point, you got to go, you know what? It's not just luck. That man knows what he's doing. He can coach.
I mean, he has such a hold on the minds of those players. They are very like-minded as Gibson is across midfield, and the crowd wants a marker. Jarrell White with the tackle. I mean, watching a P.J. Fleck practice the day before a game, I mean, that is as single-minded of a team as you're going to see.
A little bit of revival in that, too, as well. He pumps up the confidence of his players like unlike any coach I've ever seen the day before a game.
Oh, yeah.
I think that's the era we're living in, Rod. I think it's all based on positivity nowadays going forward.
We get the feeling that this Memphis team feels like they have a lot of answers with Mike Norvell calling the plays and a lot of confidence stemming from that systematically.
Brady White. Intercepted. Gardner stepped in front of it. Maybe a wrong route.
Well, this is the guy you need to stay away from. He may only be a freshman, but he is an outstanding corner. 6'2 with long arms, and he feels the game very well, much like a junior or senior cornerback. Now watch him here. He's in good position, eyes on quarterback, and his man comes off of it. Watch the toe tap. Only needs one, but he gets two in there. That's a savvy, savvy football player.
He got hit as he threw. I think that's what took something off that ball as well, Brady White.
Gardner came up a little bit gimpy after that pick.
Yeah, he's been on the bike a lot of this evening. Looks like he's had a left ankle and something else going on. They call him Sauce. He's got two pick sixes, his third pick of the year.
He's a player.
A big pick six against UCF. As Warren sees the door slam, another loss for Cincinnati on first down.
And the challenge now for Cincinnati is protecting Bryant on this second down. Remember that this is not the top thing for this offensive line. They are better at run blocking. And Memphis will bring pressure, keep a tight end around, a back, a little bit of help for your quarterback.
The cannon arm freshman in his first career start, Bryant, is wrestled down. The 14th tackle for a loss for Memphis tonight.
Dorsius 94 getting in, making this play, and they eventually collapse the quarterback, the pocket. There's only four of them. Good coverage downfield. Bryant tried to step up, but that's a really good job on the back end for Memphis in pass coverage. And now you got a long way to go on third down. You have to be worried, concerned about a turnover if you're Cincinnati. A little conservative with the ball, maybe.
Third and 12. Tipped at the line. And down to the turf. Incomplete. Xavier Cullins with the play. And at 6:31, Cincinnati has to punt.
Last two plays, this front getting after the quarterback. And when they couldn't get there, getting hands up. Cullins, number 8 that time, was in the middle, but again, those last two plays, good pressure by only 4 coming after a quarterback that Fickell would like to see stay upright.
Cincinnati has not bankrolled the turnovers very well this evening at all. They go 3 and out after that takeaway. And this punt is fair caught by Samuel. 6:24 to go in this ball game. Now we honor those who served, brought to you by Navy Federal Credit Union. And as we've learned, college sports and football are global. You see the football being played in Turkey and in California. That's a Marines versus Army Turkey Bowl you just saw. And then serving some food in Iraq and Kuwait and Germany. There's defensive coordinator Adam Fuller for Memphis, who proved once again to us that football is very deep in folks' hearts and universal. Even going back to high school, he walked into our meeting yesterday with a sweatshirt that was for his high school, Tewksbury High School in Massachusetts. He was representing because his team plays a rivalry game with Wilmington High School every year. They won, and they won 10 straight now. But that's how deep it runs. He's got a big game, and he's wearing his Tewksbury shirt.
How cool is football on Thanksgiving Day, whether it's, you know, flag or tackle or, you know, family football right before the big meal?
With Uncle Frank and yep. Aunt Lucy.
Aunt Lucy had wheels, man.
It's true. She ran a mean post corner. Second down, Gainwell. Nothing. Dropped by Myjai Sanders to set up third down with 3 timeouts left for Cincinnati.
That is a challenge for Memphis now with this third down. How about the job that Marcus Freeman's defense is doing to get the ball back? I mean, you couldn't draw this up any better if you're a defensive coordinator. Give yourself a chance with the third down and long to get the ball back.
Coordinator who played for Luke Fickell at Ohio State when he was coaching there. Reunited on the Cincinnati sideline. The Bearcats, who've won 9 in a row on a big third down, under 5 to play. White tipped at the line and incomplete. There's a marker down where White threw the ball. Let's see if it's roughing the passer. Freeman can't believe it.
You make the play to get off the field, but
running on the field is an incomplete pass. After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, defense number 21, 15-yard penalty, includes an automatic first down. That's the first unsportsmanlike foul for number 21.
A sophomore out of Jacksonville, Myjay Sanders.
How do you get these things in key moments, whether you're talking about this one now with Sanders? You get the third down stop, and then here you come at the end. Here's Sanders. He goes ahead and throws his man down to the ground. No need to do it. Last night, Ole Miss, Mississippi State, chance to tie the game, and you get an unsportsmanlike conduct for the rude celebration.
Yeah, that was an all-timer that you may have been watching live or streaming last night on Thanksgiving.
My biggest problem with it, it's not original. It's been done.
Well, yeah.
You've already seen it, and you saw the flack and the everything that happened with it at the pro level. So why would you copy someone like that, knowing you're going to get a problem? You're going to get hit with the penalty flag.
Yeah. Look at me. Look at me. Look at me. It's the culture nowadays.
At least be original, Q. If you're going to try something, to say, look at me.
I didn't know if Quint was talking about the player or he just wanted us to look at him briefly. I don't know what's going on. Second and 6 for Memphis in a 3-point game. Gainwell veering for a huge Memphis first down. Now gives it back and gets it back. First down Memphis for the second time.
Well, the reason Memphis still has the ball, Jason, is go back to this play over here. Watch this. Watch what happens there. You've got the play. Play's over. And 5 yards down, you swinging your fist at the guy and taking him down. It's unnecessary and it's selfish. And guess what? It gave Memphis the ball.
It could have lost you the game.
Yeah.
I mean, he's mad that he got lifted, right? He got lifted on the play. He felt an ego contusion.
You're right.
Right?
Timeout on the field for an injured player. Please reset the game clock to 3 minutes, 57 seconds, 3:57. The game clock will start on my signal.
So 9 seconds back on the clock. Memphis boos. It's a 3-point game. We're back in 30. Sports Center tonight after USF UCF on ESPN. Bucci and Michael Eaves. Giannis and the Bucks quest for 10, their longest win streak in nearly 33 years. Bron and the Lakers going for 10 in a row against the Wizards. And then a film session with Chase Young, the demonic defensive player for Ohio State. First down Memphis on the run from Gainwell. Now they got Gibson in the backfield, the muscular wide receiver. And they'll run it. Gibson. First down. Touchdown.
Just a stretch play with a great cutback. Start off this way. Watch him get back inside, and a tremendous block on the linebacker there. And we told you about Gibson and his explosive ability, and he made that happen after they got everybody on Cincinnati's D going the wrong way.
He galloped into that cutback.
Yeah.
Rod.
Oh, yeah.
So the penalty against Sanders is the major problem on a drive that should have been a 3-and-out, and he's just looking for solace. He's getting, I know, but on Gibson, who had the touchdown,
Mike Norvell said, hey, it took him a couple months when we finally got him here to get him in shape. We thought he could be an explosive guy. And that's a young man with big-time NFL potential somewhere on the field, right?
Yeah, that stretch play was beautiful, the way he cut back. You know, two potential guys to make a tackle, but he exploded right into that hole with a little help of one block. And, I mean, he's a dynamic player, whether you have him in the backfield or you put him in the slot or you have him on a kick return.
Sometimes the best part of the touchdown is reliving it with your friends on the sideline. He said, you see that?
Yeah. Now, remember, if this holds, Cincinnati will go home and then come right back here next week.
Keep those hotel rooms for next week. Cincinnati and Memphis would play once again. The American Conference Championship would be here in the Liberty Bowl. If Cincinnati comes back, they would host either Memphis or Navy, depending on the result of Navy's game tomorrow night. Patterson's kick through the end zone. Tomorrow night, Joe Burrow and LSU against Texas A&M, 7 Eastern on ESPN and the ESPN app. Last year, there were 146 points. And there were 7 overtime. So set your DVR for longer, by the way. Just set it for a little bit longer. Do you think A&M's got any shot against LSU? Jimbo's had a tough time beating top 10 teams recently.
I think it'll be a great game. But, no, I like the way LSU is playing. I know people talk about their defense, but the way that offense is rolling right now, I still like LSU. And LSU should be upset that they're not number one.
Absolutely. They've played out of their minds. The defense was a problem for the committee this week. As Bryant lost the football, it's down on the deck. Bryce Huff knocked it free. And Cincinnati goes backward, but Metz got on top of it. He was under siege.
Yeah. Well, if you want to look ahead for a moment for next week between these two teams, one question that comes up is, what did Luke Fickell say? Was there anything he felt, you know, we'll hold back in case we play him again? I don't think so. I think he brought everything into this game thinking, hey, we want to get to the New Year's Six game, so we're not saving anything.
We asked both coaches. They said, nope, we're throwing it all out. Place is really loud on second down now. Flag down. Bryant meandering to the 28, but the marker's back at the 9.
Number 51. That penalty enforced half the distance to the goal. Second down.
Now, the one thing both teams will do in preparation for next week is look at this tape and go, okay, what worked and what didn't work? And they can prune their playbook accordingly. One thing that Cincinnati is going to have to really understand is that they were getting killed on offense on first down with run blitzes. And they have to have an answer for that next week.
Well, who's going to start a quarterback for Cincinnati? Will it be Desmond Ridder or Ben Bryant?
The guy who's there right now is really slinging it, Q.
I don't know about that. In the second half, he's turned the ball over a number of times.
Yep.
And flirted with more turnovers.
Agreed.
So there's been good, there's been bad. Ridder offers you a little more in the run department in terms of zone read and maybe keeping some of the edge defenders occupied.
Well, but he offers you less in the passing game, and you don't know how healthy he is. So that's the dilemma for Luke Fickell over the next few days.
When Bryant's had time, he's been effective for the most part. He's 20 out of 30 in his first college start. Third and 16. Bryant, sideline, tipped away. Wanted Badaris. That was Jacoby Francis who batted it, and Memphis has not lightened up. It's fourth and 16. Gotta go, right? You do have 3 timeouts,
yeah,
but
you know, you have to, because everybody will call your names if you don't. But you know, you turn it over here, you know, you're hoping that Memphis, what, takes a knee the rest of the way.
Yeah,
you don't want to give up another touchdown.
And put more on tape if you're gonna see him next week.
Right.
Fourth and 16. Bryant, one more deep shot. Intercepted. Sanchez
to salt away what looks like a West Division crowd.
Sanchez, their most consistent defensive back, had been out. He's back in, cast on hand, sees this ball hanging in there, and doesn't have to really work too hard to come up with it. He's got that cast, uses it to help cradle the ball. That's a nice pick. He didn't have to worry about using two hands and going up high.
From just across the border in Olive Branch, Mississippi, Sanchez Blake with the pick. And on first down, Memphis needs one first down to pretty much ice this deal and go to its third straight American Conference championship game. First down run for Taylor, and Cincinnati will decide to use one of its three timeouts.
Cincinnati takes its first time out of the half. It'll be a 30-second timeout.
So Memphis, five plays of 25 plus in this game, 15 tackles for loss, and a 94-yard kickoff return for a touchdown.
Well, they've been a big play offense. They were also a big play defense tonight, particularly on first down, getting those tackles for losses, putting Cincinnati in second and long and third and long, and that is something that Cincinnati will have to address for next week's game.
Right back here at the Liberty Bowl, but it is the big plays for Memphis that pretty much are the knockout blow against everyone they play if they do win. And this is a program, I mean, very famously 10 years ago, Tommy West gets fired. He holds a press conference when he tells the fans, ask for more. Stand up right now, ask for more from your program. He was basically Howard Beale on Beale Street, telling everybody to stand up and be angry. They've put
and
a
not
lot
take it anymore
and not take it anymore. Open your window. Taylor just short of the line to gain. Second timeout coming for Cincinnati, or maybe not here. They're going to go ahead and let it run. But then you look 10 years later, Mike Norvell has built a dynasty in the American Conference.
Look, they had game day here.
Yeah.
You know,
and he said that would have been a pipe dream just a couple of years ago.
Yeah. So this program is rolling. Norvell's reputation is sky high.
New indoor facility?
Yeah, yeah. The question for Memphis long term is, can they keep him around? And if so, how long?
With Cincinnati not willing to exhaust the timeouts, Memphis wears it down to one. Taylor has the first down, and Memphis for the third straight season is going to the American Conference championship game, even though their highly thought of head coach says, hold the phone. Memphis is going to celebrate and then host next week. ...3:30 Eastern, ABC next Saturday, 8 days from now, right back here at the Liberty Bowl.
Why not do it again? This is pretty fun.
Like a whale of a game. Yep. Two teams that hadn't seen each other in 3 years, and now they're going to play back-to-back weeks, and it's going to be for the American Conference Championship Saturday on ABC. Memphis wins the West once again.
Coach.
Downstairs to Quinn.
Coach, congratulations. What was going through your mind when they drew within three in the second half?
Yeah, just continue to play the next play. I mean, that's something our guys have done. They've responded to every situation this year. You know, obviously, you know, that's a really good football team we just played, and, you know, they just stayed focused on doing our job.
What do you think made the difference?
You know, the heart of these kids. I mean, we got a tremendous group of young men. They battle for everything to win our third straight West Division title. To be able to host the championship game here next week, something we're really proud of, and just